Well, good day, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. If you recall the last video, or it was a documentary of Ethan Moses and I constructing this 8x10 format sliding box camera down at the QueLab Maker Space here in Albuquerque. This was a camera designed by Ethan, made from laser cut plywood panels based on an original design of a sliding box camera that I had made years ago. It uses a 23 centimeter f4.5 Fujinon Xerox machine lens, a barrel lens. And if you remember from the last video, we had gotten the camera assembled, but we were basically missing a lens board and a lens mounted up front. Well, in this last intervening week, Ethan has designed and 3D printed a plastic holder bracket for the Xerox machine lens that clamps the Xerox machine lens in place. And then these six machine screws hold the lens holder onto the lens board, which is in turn secured by these two sliding brackets. So now we have a nice, flush, clean design for this lens. The lens actually sits in the back of the camera, in the interior of the camera, instead of protruding out front. This morning, we had the New Mexico Film Photographers Group hold their monthly meeting down at QueLab, where Ethan and I demonstrated the use of this camera with the hydrogen peroxide, citric acid, black and white reversal process, and the RA4 color reversal process, both with seated portraits under high-powered strobe lighting. So there's a short little video here I shot of that demonstration this morning, so stay tuned. Well, hey everybody, it's Joe Van Cleve, and yes, I'm overdressed. I'm overdressed for being at QueLab. This is Albuquerque's Makerspace. It's Sunday morning, and the New Mexico film photographers are having a little meeting at the QueLab. Why would we be doing that? Because Ethan and I are gonna be doing a demonstration of the box camera here. Yes, this is the box camera that we had made last week from laser printed parts using a Xerox machine lens. We're going to set up and do a color positive 8x10 portrait demonstration.
Whoa. That's a lot of power. How many watt seconds do you have there?
So that's 2,000 watt seconds.
Okay.
Sometimes I have seen the citric acid start to turn this exposed part of the paper kind of a coppery color, and I was so sure it happened, and I told Joe that it would happen, and I showed him, and it just didn't happen. It did not. All right, try some more hydrogen peroxide, and then we'll see that what's yellow bleaches out pretty quickly. This is rather old chemistry, so, you know, often takes a little bit of time here. Make myself a prototype plug. Oh, here we go. Now it's really starting to bleach, right? And probably, so when we do this in the dark room, if it's under dim lights, often I will like to turn the lights on so I can see what is totally bleached, right? So you get like sort of a solarization effect if you don't bleach everything out, right? Because generally like the highlights will be left with a dark image. I don't think it will completely, but.
So have you ever poured the wrong one back in the jar?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, now we're doing the study in salt.
Okay, so this is
the magic part?
No, this is just going to clear any sort of brown haze that might form during the development step. Again, not sure what it's doing, but it's, you know, it's some sort of clearing agent. It's type of clearing agent. It's more defined, positive.
Cool.
And you could, I don't know, you know, at home when I really care, I might do this for a few minutes, this clearing step.
Because
it doesn't seem like you can
not
do.
Not that Marco matters.
No, I mean, Marco's beautiful. Okay, here's the magic. So now we have
So you're going to put the Dectol on again?
Yeah. Now we have the kombucha.
We have a silver halide layer that is the positive image of the original that hasn't been developed.
Oh, look at that.
Look at that.
Whoa.
Wow.
Awesome.
Oh, that's cool.
So Marco looks like he just came off Everest.
This is going to be a little dark.
This is kind of like wet plate.
Because I just don't have the stroke power, but I have 6 more speedotrons.
I like the look, though.
Yeah, that's cool.
For me, but, you know, just
then you can selenium tone this afterwards.
Yeah, right.
And will this stop on its own, or do you have to...
So this goes to completion, and the interesting part is you don't need to fix it because...
There's no silver to remove.
You could, right? Because there's hardeners and fixers and other things, but this is done, right? So I am just going to rinse my funnel.
It's a magic kombucha.
Then you just wash it.
Really, gloves would be good, but maybe the next version won't leak so much.
Gloves would still be.
Ooh, still too bright, but much closer.
Amazing that it needs.
Wow, I see you.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's much better. You ever thought about a career modeling?
Here we go.
Color developer.
Here we go.
Again, this one's going to be bright. It takes a couple shots to get dialed in because I'm stupid, but I think this will be satisfying.
Yeah, might have to be a little bit bigger.
This is so cool.
You should.
Hell, I don't have quite the handy gene to do it.
You can do it in trays in the dark room.
Yeah, you can do this.
Yeah.
Oh, look.
Yeah, it looks neat.
You probably that is very cool.
So you'll notice that, like, the dark, it's not so blown out yet because the lights, right, the highlights have still the black and white negative masking them. Pretty nice contrast now, but it will be higher contrast, unfortunately, once we
fix color it. The color will be better.
It's like, it reminds me of one of those, remember those Kmart pictures you used to get?
Yeah.
You know, you'd go and set for the portraitist, you know, with your family.
Hey, Joe and I do fine art.
This isn't Kmart.
This is not Kmart quality, Becky.
It's KM art.
I'm getting thrown right out of here. I brought a digital camera today.
No, that camera's awesome.
It's K-F art.
Oh, F art. Yeah. Oh, I like that. That's my fine art.
Catchy, yeah.
I like that.
I'm going to take these things off.
Oh, I like this.
You're dripping with the
floor. Yeah, don't touch it.
I'm not going to touch it.
Oh, I'm sorry. All right. And again, you know, we could go for pure white borders or pure black borders here, but I kind of like the splotchy Polaroid look.
Yeah,
yeah.
I like it too.
And I was thinking about maybe making different frame inserts for it, just, you know.
Okay.
That looks great.
So in practice, this camera worked really well. We did have to apply the colored filters, the gel filters, over the front of the lens with some tape. We were just using some contrast control filters, the kind you would use for black and white printing. I think we're using a double zero and a zero and a 1/2 grade filter together to color balance the color print shot. In the future, we'll probably build some kind of a little plywood holder for those gels so that we won't have to keep taping them on and off to the front of the camera. The other modification or improvement we might make to this design is a pull shutter or a sliding shutter that my original design had. So in the case of this camera thus far, we've only been really testing it under indoor lighting with powerful strobe lights where we don't really need a guillotine shutter like you would for outdoor shooting. But it would be nice to have a pull shutter that would certainly make this camera a little more useful and flexible for like landscape photography, for instance. But it proved to be very handy, very rugged and useful today, and I was really pleased with it. The original prototype was built in a rectangular cross section with the paper oriented so you can only shoot a landscape oriented picture. This camera was designed purposefully with a square cross-section so the whole back of the camera can be removed and you can insert it either this way in portrait orientation or rotate it 90 degrees and put it in landscape orientation. For the two pictures that we did today, we shot them this way in portrait, which means you load the film holders into the front of the ground glass from the top. Which reminds me, somebody recently did ask me regarding the original prototype that I had hand-built. They asked me, where did you get this idea for this design? And I said, well, it was actually an online website of the George Eastman House Museum, where they have this enormous collection of cameras from the early formative years of photography in the 19th century. And I noticed a lot of those kind of cameras were these kinds of sliding box cameras, or what you might call tailboard cameras, because they have this base that sits underneath the camera and extends out on the tail of the camera, and the rear film plane ground glass part slides in and out for focusing, and the front lens board part of the camera is stationary on the tailboard. That was kind of the design that I had seen in a lot of these early camera examples and figured, well, that's a real simple design to build. It really is. There was another interesting innovation that Ethan had come up with, which was a combination film holder and developing tank. And it was roughly, I'll say, about an inch and a half thick. And it fits into the back of the camera where your film holder does. But of course, it's going to throw off the focus because it's not going to place the paper, the film plane, at the same place that your ground glass was located. And so Ethan built a wooden spacer to fit in front of the ground glass viewer so that it'll locate the ground glass at the same location relative to the lens that the paper or film will be in this extended fat holder, and so that I can compose the image on the ground glass and it'll be in focus on the paper. And so it has, this holder has a pour spout light trap fitting, kind of like a development tank has, and you thread on a 3D printed funnel. The yellow funnel you'll see in this video, and then it enables him to pour chemical into this flat little sealed up tray and process the steps in total darkness that need to be processed in total darkness, like for instance the black and white developer and stop bath, the first two steps of the RA4 color reversal process. I had a few comments on the previous video about whether the plans are available yet for laser cutting this camera out, and or whether this will be available as an assemble-it-yourself kit. And so Ethan is still working on the final touches of a finished commercially sellable design. And this particular camera that we're working with is really like a working prototype that we're using as a way of testing out ideas and getting it into a finished commercial form. So when we do come up with a finished sellable version, I'll let you guys know. It'll be on Ethan's Cameradactyl website.
Well, we had a good little couple hours here at QueLab demonstrating both the black and white reversal process using citric acid and hydrogen peroxide and the color RA4 reversal process. The New Mexico Film Photographers Group here had a great time, and they had a tour of the QueLab here in Albuquerque. Okay, guys, until next time, stay creative. Have yourselves a great day. Bye-bye.